Greetings, this is J.R. Dickey. Thanks for tuning into our podcast. And by the way, don't forget our website, graceandtruth.net. I hope you're having a great day, but if not, hang with me. It's about to get better. You know, I've got a group of guys that I meet with occasionally, and they help me out with this particular lesson. I hope you enjoy it. Has it ever occurred to you that there is something that you're doing all the time, every moment of the day, it is with you? Even when you sleep, you can only slightly escape it, and then when you wake, there it is again. Sometimes it's superficial. Sometimes it's profound. It's your thoughts, your thinking, your mind, and your heart. It is the engine or energy of your actions and your speech, and from the beginning, it has been the target of our enemy, for at the very moment of her interaction with the serpent, Eve and then Adam were changed in their thinking and trapped by sin. Ever since, mankind's thinking has been twisted, prideful, turned inward, and completely futile. There are a couple of important terms we read about in the Bible: mind and heart. They are similar, and definitions of the two overlap somewhat, but you can consider the heart as the inner man, the once living spirit of man that has been corrupted unto death by sin, while the mind is the soul, the self, and when saved, the living part of each person. Now, because of sin, the heart of mankind is indeed a treacherous thing. In fact, the prophet Jeremiah wrote, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?" That's Jeremiah 17:9. And Jesus spoke of this very clearly himself. He said in Matthew 9, "But Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, 'Why do you think evil in your hearts?'" And from Mark 7, we read, "For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lewdness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness." Wow. All these evil things come from within and defile a man. Now, God's word enlightens us concerning our thinking and ultimately gives us hope. Let's consider, think, that is, about what it has to tell us. We can reach back into 1 Chronicles to start with, where we read, "As for you," this is David speaking, "my son Solomon, know the God of your father and serve him with a loyal heart and with a willing mind. For the Lord searches all hearts and understands all the intent of the thoughts. If you seek him, he will be found by you, but if you forsake him, he will cast you off forever." Okay, let me emphasize first, no one is born again by a simple intellectual assent to the grace of God. If you're a child of the Most High, it is his gift to you, accomplished by his Holy Spirit, birthing in your soul triumphant faith or trust in what Christ did for you: forgiveness, life, union with him. We commonly say that it's a matter of the inner man, not simply the head. When sin entered mankind's existence in the Garden of Eden, our spirit, man's spirit, which God had created, died. That is, it was separated from God. After that point, and prior to Calvary, our soul, which came about by God's Spirit breathing life into a lifeless body, was left with the dominant influence of the flesh, We read in Genesis chapter 2, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground," now there's his flesh, "and breathed into his nostrils the breath, the ruach of life," that's his spirit, "and man became a living being," or literally soul. That's Genesis 2:7. The Bible does not talk about saving the spirit of man, though it does mention prior to Jesus lifting up or retaining the spirit of man. But rather, it says that Christ saved our souls. That's because when we are saved, his spirit takes up residence in us, in our soul. Now, in Chronicles, we see that David told his son Solomon that God wants both our heart and our mind. And that's because your thoughts originate from both places. The dead part of you, that is the heart, and the living part of you, that is the mind or soul. Now, Jeremiah said in Jeremiah 17, "I, the Lord, search the heart, I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings." Now, the thoughts of the heart are vain or futile. Psalms 94:11 says, "The Lord knows the thoughts of man, that they are futile." Now, that word futile comes from another word meaning emptiness or vanity. Figuratively, something transitory or unsatisfactory. But possibly as a foreshadowing of the work, if you would, of salvation, Proverbs declares in Proverbs 16, "Commit your works to the Lord, and your thoughts will be established," that is, to be firm or stable. Fortunately, and contrary to us, God's thoughts are absolutely pure, perfectly, and eternally pure. We read, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." That's Isaiah 55. Jeremiah compliments that when we read, "For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope." And he knows our thoughts, good and bad. Psalms 39 says, "You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thought afar off." Now, I say good and bad because even though we are saved in Christ, God has temporarily left us in a body of dead flesh. And both our new living soul as well as our dead fleshly heart are sources of our thoughts. I suggest that this is indeed to teach us while we're here humility, which will be to our benefit in heaven. And until we are there, we do battle spiritually with the dead flesh simply because it is incongruent with our new life as it tries to poison our thinking. Now, the battle is the Lord's. He is our shield, our defense, our high tower, and the unbeatable victor who uses these battles to teach us many things. 2 Corinthians 10 says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God, for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ." Now, this obedience is not obedience to Christ, but rather the obedience of Christ, the obedience he displayed to us in obeying the Father's will all the way to the cross, to the grave, and to the throne of heaven. Submitted, perfect, humble obedience. And Paul wrote of this battle even in his own life. He said in Romans 7, "But I see another law in my members," that is, the flesh, "warring against the law of my mind, bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. Oh, wretched man that I am! Who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin." With all this in mind, the scriptures leave us with hope and guidance concerning our thoughts. Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says, "And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." That's the work of God's Spirit, by the way, "that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Let nothing," this is in Philippians, "let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind," that is honest, godly humility, "let each esteem others better than himself. Let this mind be in you, which also was in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men." Philippians chapter 2. And in Colossians, we read simply, "Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth." And in 1 Peter, we read, "Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ." And the good news is that in thinking or being this way, you gain perfect peace. Isaiah sums it up. He said, "But you will keep him in perfect peace." The Bible says there, peace, peace. "Whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you." Now may the Lord grant you peace in the midst of any storm and faith to trust him. Look for our next podcast, and may you realize more of his grace today.